excited to talk to you. Before we do, I'm going to do a little house announcement for Tyler. Real quick, guys, remember, we're going to be doing the Startup Showcase winner announcements after Tyler and Dana's panel, which is the next session, so make sure you stay for that. But how you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing well. You know, you caused a bit of a hullabaloo last year, a kerfuffle, whatever, outdated word can I think of. But when you said recipes are dead, and I thought a lot about that over the past year, and I started to think, are they dead or are they just changing?
Well, I think recipes are dead in the way that vinyl records have a very soft spot for a lot of people emotionally, right? Or the way paper maps are, you know, still around in a way, but when's the last time you actually pulled one out and used one versus using the GPS in your car to get you from A to B? And not only does your GPS get you from A to B precisely, but tracks the timing, it tracks the current traffic, it can tell you where to get gas, where to get a cup of coffee, that kind of thing. And I think the smart kitchen is in that place right now where recipes are just sort of antiquated, right? The way they're written, right? It's one way in, one way out. You have to have all the ingredients on hand to be able to make that very specific project. And if you don't, it's not really going to work out. And I just don't think people cook that way anymore. And I think when you talk to people about sort of like the cookbook industry or recipes, the way they're written, they always have this, you know, sort of soft spot for, oh, I love cookbooks and they're so beautiful, and I agree and I love them. I have thousands of cookbooks. I've written 16. Like, I love it. But I think that where technology is today, we're about to make this gigantic leap in the future, and it's really all about personalization. Right, we're creating recipe content and digital content that is more technique-driven than it is more sort of like the full-blown idea of a finished project. Right, so if I'm really interested in watching a technique on how to get panko breadcrumbs on a chicken breast to stick where I can pan fry them and it won't come off. Right, not necessarily that. The entire idea of mayonnaise with a buffalo mozzarella and fresh tomatoes and basil, because I'm lactose intolerant, it's not tomato season, I don't have any fresh basil, yada, yada. But it's really more about like the technique-driven idea that I think is really on the cusp of something new.
You know, I saw an announcement last week by Netflix that they're going to be moving towards doing non-linear-based storytelling. They're going to move to choose-your-own-adventure storytelling. I thought that's like the best idea I've ever heard. Black Mirror, choose your own story. That sounds fantastic. But I started to think, could you do that in a recipe format? Like, could we just choose our own story when it comes to recipe and cookbooks?
This is where we are, and it's very exciting. I've been working with Innit for 2 years now. And Innit is an amazing food technology company that is really going after the kitchen space in a holistic way from a lot of different directions. And we've spent the last 2 years creating recipe content that can be broken apart in modular format where you can choose the protein, you can choose the sauce, you can choose the vegetable and the carbohydrate, and even the cooking method on each. And then all those will reassemble themselves as a video that you can play that's your very specific recipe that you just chose on the spot. And inside the app right now, there are over 23,000 different permutations of recipes. And so people can have more choices for cooking options than they really have nights on planet Earth. Right? So you'll never run out of ideas. You'll never run out of concepts for food. And I think that's really interesting. And this is kind of where we are, kind of taking it back to personalization. Like, to me, when I hop in a car and hit my outcome of where I want to go on my GPS, that GPS tells me where I want to go specifically. It's not sort of like broad base of like, here is A to B, but here's how I can get to A to B. And I think we're totally in that space right now.
It's like there's this tension I'm sensing where we're seeing all these new tools, new screens coming to the kitchen that will enable and democratize the ability to cook great food. But then at the same time, I talked about this yesterday, where we're seeing articles where people are saying, the kitchen will be dead in 10 years, we don't need kitchens, because our kids will just press buttons and robots will deliver food. So are these worlds that are gonna, are these two competing visions for the world? Or can they be coexistent?
Well, I think that the last mile that most technology companies wrestle with, it's the most expensive, most arduous, most difficult part of any kind of concept to complete. like Uber, you hit a button and a car shows up. Like that's the magic trick, right? That everyone's really trying to figure out. How do you hit a button and something magical happen for people and change their life in a way and really consolidate an industry? So we're on the verge of where, you know, Airbnb sort of, you know, has consolidated travel and hotel accommodations and reinvented that entire genre, and where Uber has reinvented transportation in a way. And we're on the verge of having that level of technology where you can make a decision on what you want for dinner, and then you can choose the outcome. And now what I really like about the personalization and where technology is coming, it's having your hand held the entire process, right? So I've often said that I think grocery stores do a huge disservice to home cooks, because it's so all over the place, the way they market, the way they merchandise. You know, there's 250,000 SKUs in the average grocery store, and how am I supposed to know that the salmon and the seafood aisle and the broccoli and the produce aisle and the teriyaki sauce on the international aisle all fit together? How am I supposed to know that in a way? So I think re-merchandising that in a way where the products themselves start to speak to one another in concert, right? They start to speak to one another in a way where you can walk up to, and we've been working on this technology at Innit for the last almost year, and it's kind of amazing. So you can walk up to the poultry aisle, and you can find a organic chicken sitting there with a QR code, and you can hover your telephone over the QR code, and it'll take you into the app, and it'll show you a video of how to prepare that individual chicken, right? And then you take it home, and then you can go through the app and then see three or four different ways, choose your own adventure of how you want to prepare this. And then you can snap it into your smart oven, and we're connecting with different partners all over the world on waveform cooking that will take that individual chicken, weigh it, identify it, and cook it with 29 different temperature and time steps that makes that thing perfect. So you can track a success, right? And the culinary world, the idea of having all the knowledge that I have and chefs have, you know, we've been collecting this stuff and honing our particular skills for years, but you could take everything that's in our brain and you can create a digital formula of that, right? That's all binary, right? It's ones and zeros, or it's all a formula, right? So if you could hit a button and the oven will preheat and it'll roast, and then it'll drop the temperature and slowly finish it so you get the crust and the succulents at the same time. Like, that's kind of where we are in the world right now when it comes to recipe development. So we're kind of climbing out of the kitchen dark ages. We're climbing out of this because there hasn't been really that much innovation, subtle innovation, right? I'm not to say there's no innovation in the kitchen, but a refrigerator has kept things cold for a long time, right? An oven with, you know, different processes and different, like a convection oven was probably one of the greatest innovations in the home cooking genre in a really, really long time. And then there's you know, infrared and the broiler and all that kind of stuff, but it still doesn't speak to the food the way the food really wants to be prepared. They don't really communicate in a way, and I think they should. So we're climbing out of the kitchen dark ages in a way that is so interesting, it's so fantastic. Will robots deliver? They're kind of already doing it right now in a way, right? Like the way UPS completely automates their trucks and their drivers to make sure they can kind of, you know, maximize the traffic and the time and get the most packages out in a very specific day. We're already in that world in a way.
Right? You're a little bit more embracing of technology than some chefs. In that, I think a lot, when I look at the kitchen, the culinary world, there is some, almost a Luddite resistance in some ways against the invasion of technology, because some of them say it's the last kind of holdout against, as an artistic endeavor, right? And if we look to an analog of, like, as we saw digital tools come into the artistic world, right? And you started to see, like, analog artists and analog photographers who use film convert to start using digital tools. There was a moment in time where people said, we don't want to do this, it's not as artistic. But now everyone embraces digital tools. Do you see a world where eventually culinary creators, even at the highest levels, will embrace digital tool sets? Or do you think there will always be pushback against it?
We're unleashing creativity. Like, this is progress. And that's what I love about it. So as I'm a filmmaker, I'm a restaurateur, I'm a tech investor, I'm a cookbook author, I'm a winemaker. I do a lot of things, right? But to me, the where the innovation lies on the next frontier of cooking is the most inspiring from a home cook's standpoint, right? I mean, even think about like how your the camera on your cell phone, right? It has filters, right? And everyone's Instagram game or how they use Instagram as a way to communicate, like people are becoming so incredibly apt at creating art that I think the underground is way bigger than the surface if you take a lot of the technical difficulties out of creating concepts, right? Especially creating recipes. So if you can share a method with someone on how, and Instagram and social media has done a remarkable job of creating what I think is the absolute best generation of chefs America has ever had, hands down. The chefs that are in America right now would blow away my generation, the generation before me, and the generation before that, like hands down.
But are they killing off not killing off, but like, you started in a world when it was cable and linear television is largely the dominant formats to which chefs came to the world. And now we see Instagram chefs and et cetera, but it doesn't seem like we're seeing as many celebrity chefs. So has it changed to we won't see as many Anthony Bourdains or Tyler Florences, and you'll just see a million Instagram chefs?
Well, to me, having the platform is very interesting. We just launched a new show called Bite Club on Food Network, and we were doing the rounds in Los Angeles. We did KTLA and we did the talk, and I was talking to the publicist from the Food Network about remember the days when you had to go do the Today Show and you had to go do Good Morning America to get the word out on a very specific project, or no one really really knew about it in a way. And now that's like, not only is that a spoke in the wheel for a marketing initiative, but sometimes it's actually the least important, right? I remember even going to big festivals, New York City Food and Wine Festival, South Beach. Like, you had to go do that if you wanted to sell cookbooks. You had to go do those kind of things. And now it's like, if you want to go, if you have something interesting, like, I create more impressions just putting a chicken in the oven on a Sunday afternoon and doing a pictorial on Instagram stories, or posting something kind of fun on Twitter. Like, I get way more impressions doing that than having to pack up, fly to Miami, cook for 650 people, and then try to record that and monetize that somehow.
Do you get competitive about it? I asked Richard Blaze in an off-camera, off-stage interview. He said it's one of the ways in which I can actually measure my success against other chefs now, because those types of metrics haven't largely been available. So do you get competitive on the social media clicks and numbers and follows?
Sure, without a question, and sometimes it's kind of petty, right? Because you get hooked on how many views. Like, I'm a filmmaker. I just posted the trailer for my new film Uncrushable last night, and it's had 67,000 views in a little bit less than 12 hours, right? And it's still climbing. And to me, like, those kind of metrics, like, that's the new Q score. Like, how relevant are you? Like, how many likes do you have? How many comments do you have? And those things are really, creating like this new level of relevancy. But in the big scheme of things, it democratizes anything. So anybody can step into the world on an even playing field with anybody else in the world now. And I think that's really, really interesting. And I think it only encourages creativity. I think where the underground is way bigger than the surface when it comes to creativity and cooking content. Like, we're just scratching the surface. So what I love about the idea exchange with social media specifically, like, if an idea pops up in New York City, right? And all of a sudden, a couple of chefs are kind of into this new idea or this new trend, and then you start to see a reflection of that in Los Angeles or in San Francisco. Somebody's doing it here too, but it gets modified in a way, and then it bounces back to New York, and then someone's taking that concept. So now, like, restaurants in Madison, Wisconsin, and Asheville, North Carolina, and Fresno, California, like these, and some of these things that used to be just flyover states, like, they're starting to innovate in a way, because, like, all that information, When I was a kid, I'm 47 now. When I was 25 or 30, you'd have to fly from New York City to San Francisco, hop in the car and drive to the French Laundry, you know, eat dinner, take all pictures with a camera, you know, put that on an SD card.
What's a camera?
Yeah, exactly. Put that back in your laptop, take that back to your staff, and then show them what that experience was all about and say, this is what people are doing in the kitchen in different cities around the world. And now you see what these restaurants post for specials every night. So the idea of information exchange in a really, really rapid rate is producing a higher level of creativity than we've ever had. And I think it's fabulous.
Could we see that level of metric tracking around how Tower of Florence converts, ultimately not only being social, but actually convert into the kitchen, right? So as devices get connected, we start to talk about software, what you guys are doing within it, and other platforms, people can actually see, okay, Tower's converting on a cook, or this many people are cooking with Tower's cooking. Is this something you get excited about?
I'm very excited on a lot of different levels, because we're trying to approach the conversation with end users and home cooks and enthusiasts at a new level, right? So here's a recipe and here's a pretty picture of the finished dish. Doesn't really cut it anymore, because it's not as interactive, it's not as educational, it's not as intuitive. And it leaves so many holes in there. Like, I don't really know what you're talking about, right? So we just launched this new service with Shopwell, which is sort of the sister platform within it. And we're this is what's so amazing. We're launching the idea of having a pantry list of things, right? Instead of having a recipe, here's my pantry. Because with a recipe, you can make one dish. But with a pantry, you can make hundreds of dishes. And I think approaching it from that different level, approaching the conversation of like how
it's less like of a top down, it's more of a bottoms up,
right? Cook, right? And that's where everybody wants to learn, right? So it's about technique, and it's about giving somebody the ability, you know, to like showing them how to fish versus giving them a fish, where people just take concepts and then they riff on them anyway. So let's create whole platforms on people actually having the ability to be creative at home and think for themselves and start off with really great techniques and then use things that are in season, they have in front of them. They don't have to go to the grocery store to buy all of it. You know, you can sort of kind of step up in a way. And we think that's the whole new wave of interacting with people in the future and connecting back to the kitchen and also showing usership in a way, right? Because you could say like, so my shopping list on Shopwell right now it's kind of deep and it's amazing. So if you're like, how do I cook all these things and how can you cook better? I think you got to start with better tools and better ingredients, right? And things that you can kind of scale at home. And that's what I love.
We have 30 seconds left. I just want to ask you one last question. If you were to give some advice to an up and coming chef who wanted to kind of follow a similar career path to what you did, what would that be?
Well, I think you have to start off with a very, very strong social media platform, right? I think you have to, and you have to be very honest with yourself, right? Like, is my work commercially competitive? What am I, the message that I'm putting out, the food that I'm putting out, the dishes I'm putting out, who I associate with, what's my social philanthropic point of view, right? Like, are you the complete package? Is your work commercially competitive? And if it's not, like, I don't believe in failure. I think you either win or you learn, right? There's no such thing as failing. So when you realize that you tried a project and you spend a bunch of money working on something and it didn't quite work out, like, you just take that information and you retool it and you sharpen it back up for the next one. And I think that's the world we live in, right? So what my advice to a young culinary person, a young culinary startup, is to take advantage of all of the free aspects that weren't even available 10 years ago, right? And now they are. You can get your work, you can get in and speak to other people in your industry through direct message. It all goes down in the DM, which is amazing, right? Connecting with different partners and trying to hook up with new people. And you know, if you're trying to like make connections, there's a woman named Ali Romero who she's always kind of my fun case study. Like, she's a fan, right? I know we just went over by a minute, but she's been following me on social media for years and years and years, and she's a career changer, right? She's sort of a midlife career changer, and she really wanted to get into the culinary world in a really big way. So she would direct message me and say, "Chef, I see that you are going to be at the Pebble Beach Food and Wine Festival, or I see that you're going to be in South Beach. Can I just come and just cook with you?" right? Can I just come and cook with you? And she's been doing this stuff for a couple of years now. I would show up, I'm like, Allie, you're here again? Oh my God, high five. And then she has kind of built that into a career. Now she is she's working with Heston out of Napa as one of their spokespeople, and she's and her social media game is on fire.
That's awesome,
right? So to me, like, and she's just a mom at home who had the drive and the passion to do something really incredible, and now she's monetizing that in a really big way with top level sponsors, and I think that's kind of fantastic. So you have to believe in it, you have to dig in, and you have to do it every single day, and you have to be aware of the content you're putting out. If it's not commercially competitive, then do something that you think is.
Great. Well, thanks for those last final words. Let's give Tyler a big round of applause. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Good to see you.